It's time for a sit-down with some Catholic educators to learn something from people who teach for a living. Join Kyle, Mr. Zac Coyle, and guests on this educational journey into our Catholic schools and the people that make them great.
Spirit in the schools! Welcome to Spirit in the Schools. I'm Kyle Hyman, here with our... You should just actually be the host of this. I was going to say co-host, but like you just take over. Mr. Zac Coyle.
Thank you, Kyle.
At St. John's New Haven.
It's great to be back with you.
Yeah. So happy Catholic Schools Week.
Thank you very much. We're thrilled to be featured with you and to share kind of the joy in our school with Redeemer Radio and our listeners. And I'm here and thrilled to introduce one of our team, Mrs. Peggy Beuchel. Mrs. Beuchel is our resource director. And I think there might be a lot of listeners that don't really know much about what a resource program is.
Sure.
And the overwhelming level of love that Peggy brings to the work. So I am very excited to introduce her. And I thought, Peggy, if you'd be willing to share a little bit about what it means to have a resource program and what kind of services we offer our kids. Because really, Catholic Schools Week is about loving our children. And That's the same as any week. Every week is Catholic Schools Week. So here is Peggy Beuchel. We are thrilled to have you with us.
Thank you, Mr. Coyle. Our resource program here at St. John the Baptist Catholic School in New Haven is run by myself, and I have two other individuals who help me on my team, Miss Mary and Mrs. Burnham. And so they are instrumental in helping all of our children succeed.
You know, I think they are instrumental. They're wonderful people to work with. I think one of the things that our listeners may not know, Kyle, is that, you know, we think sometimes of the public schools offering more services for kids that might have a learning need or might be at an accelerated place. Mm-hmm. You know, they might need a higher level program.
Yeah.
And so it's something Peggy brings to the table every day with Mrs. Burnham and Mrs. Tuttle's help, Miss Mary and Miss Jackie. And what they do with kids throughout our building is something that's deeply exciting. And so I don't know if there's something from your day, Peggy, that you'd be willing to share about how you work with kids, maybe in the junior high, maybe in the primary levels as well, and just seeing about how we meet kids where they are. Mm-hmm. And I think our listeners would love hearing about it.
Thank you again, Mr. Coyle. Each of our students come to us with very unique learning needs. And I get to work with the children who have the most unique learning needs. And what we do with them is we try to figure out which skills that they need to learn, and how they learn is also important too. Mm-hmm. Most children will learn from the overall teaching in the classroom, and some of our unique learners need that smaller group type of learning. What I do in the elementary part is we kind of target those students who are having a difficult time with learning how to read. And mm-hmm. so we put in different types of interventions to help them read, to increase their reading scores. This year, what we've been working on a lot more with even our youngest learners is some of those have unique behavior needs. And they have a hard time coming into school and regulating to our structure. So we've started this year with what's called, the kids call it an exercise room. And what it is, it's a sensory room. Yeah. And so those kids get to experience those different senses. And so I tell them they're going to come up and exercise. And so we do jumping, we do rolling, we do somersaults. And that kind of just helps them at the beginning of their day to go in and to get regulated. And so they're ready to sit and listen for class.
Yeah. As a parent, do you have any techniques or strategies or suggestions for talking or working with a child that might benefit from some of your activities or something like that? Basically, helping them without making them feel like there's something wrong with them or that they're lesser of a person because they might need some kind of special attention.
We all learn differently.
Yeah.
Every student, even we as adults, we learn differently. And so if we can just catch that child right where they are and figure out how they're learning, and parents at home, don't demand too much out of the child.
Hmm.
You know, if they come home from school and you think there's a lot of homework going on, make sure that they get that brain break before you start in for homework. That would be my suggestion.
Okay.
You know, and I used to do that with my boys when they were little also. It's just like, you're going to come home, we're going to have a snack, and then we're going to look at our homework.
Sure.
You know, and they don't have to sit and do the homework all at one time. You know, if it's a child who needs to get up and move, let that child get up and move for a little bit, for about 5 or 10 minutes, and then come back and, you know, start back in on their homework.
And I think Peggy really is a master of that. I was working with her the other day with a group of three of our younger students in kindergarten. And, you know, in a half hour, you know, you use 15 or 20 many different strategies for helping them learn reading, learning mm-hmm. how to read. And a big part of that was movement. You know, they got up, 10 or 15 times in that time, just even to switch seats and be active and kind of give the brain a quick little interval to rest and refocus on the next learning activity. So it's a great activity to do.
Well, and it seems like that's something that's becoming more common, more popular, that we're, I don't know if there's science that's coming out realizing that this is an effective way. Definitely seems contrary to the pictures that you might see from 50 years ago, the classroom yes. where everybody yep. sits there. If you move, then you're in the corner for the yep. rest of the day or something like that, but very strict schools. But now we're realizing, you know what, that there's actually a benefit
that's not going
to
help that child,
letting them
right?
move or
yeah, and yeah. to really compliment Peggy, you know, she was talking about some different behaviors that we're helping to manage and redirect well this year. And so, you know, I think what somebody might not know about a Catholic school, we might have this image, maybe an administrator has a teacher refer a student, right? Mm-hmm. And the student's done something that just wasn't the finest decision. They've interrupted the class, something like that. What's the traditional model in a school, public or private? Well, the administrator sends that kid home, right? Okay, you can't be here today. And it may not have to be a formal suspension, but, you know, you've prevented teaching and learning from happening. And so you can't be here at school today. And it might, you know, be longer. Well, that interrupts the family, that interrupts the kid's learning, their development. And where I really see Christ in Peggy, and I'd love to just let our listeners know that Peggy is joined by other resource directors in other Catholic schools. We might get that referral, right? Our kids are great here, and it's a joy to work with them, but they're like any human being. They're going to have a bad moment. They're sure. going to have a bad day. So we get that referral, maybe in a very young grade, the kid's been screaming. They've totally derailed, you know, in that moment, the class from learning. So of course we get them out of the classroom for a moment, but Peggy is a master of redirecting that, maybe that anger or that hurt, and helping the child know they're loved and choose him or herself to re-enter that learning environment. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously we're not going to share an example of just any one specific student and, sure. and to embarrass them, but maybe you could talk a little bit about how you give them a choice. And usually Peggy can create a different learning environment for them for maybe 5 or 10 minutes. Mm. And that's enough release time that their mind has moved on from what upset them. And they're ready to come back into that classroom and learn and be successful. So I don't know if there's something, if you remember about how you do that choice or even one thing that's on my heart.
Mondays and Tuesdays are...
they're the hardest. Yeah.
Mondays and Tuesdays keep me busy.
Settling
yes.
in.
Yes,
still.
Yes. Yeah. And so no child wants to have a meltdown. Hmm. No child wants to, you know, be out of control. They don't want that. And that's how I go into the situation. It's just like I see my role as meeting that child where they are, whatever emotions that they're displaying. And then I just start to talk to them and calm them down. Mm-hmm. And I might bring something. I might bring a game with me. I might bring a toy with me and just start talking to that child and just see where he's at, where he or she is at, and where they need to go. And then I just start giving them choices. It's just like, would you like to stay here and play the game, or do you want to go out in the hallway and play the game?
Right.
You know, and so it's that, then that lets the child think that they're in control because now they're making the choice.
Yes.
And so it's just distraction is the key. And so just distract them and get them focused on something else. Get that behavior regulated back where they can talk and where they can be calm. Yeah. And then address the issue. Okay, why do you think that you were upset? What caused you to be upset? Uh-huh. And then we talk about that. And then we give them replacement behaviors so that they know what they can do next time if they get frustrated. And so we really try to encourage them to use words instead of behaviors to explain what's going on in their little mind.
So. I like the options thing too. We've done this with bedtime. Like, do you want to go up yep. by yourself or do you want to go on my back?
Yes.
Both options are going to bed.
Yes.
I don't
yes,
care which one you
are.
Pick. But yeah, they get a little bit of choice there.
Yeah. And I just think that's such a great thing to hear in Catholic Schools yeah. Week, because there's this feeling sometimes maybe in the general population. I think if we have people who are really committed to their faith listening right now, maybe not. But in the general population, maybe feeling that, well, you know, a teacher might be against my child. You know, mm. they're angry at my child. They're out to get my child. I am so joyful here that never applies to our teachers, and they are so for our kids. And as is often the case too, Kyle, switching gears a little bit, in Catholic schools, we often wear many hats. Mm-hmm. And so I really want to compliment Peggy too, because, you know, we're talking about our younger learners and how we're redirecting and helping them, rather than go home for the day, re-engage with their learning.
Mm-hmm.
But if we didn't have that resource program, they might feel lost. They mm-hmm. might feel like, I can't get this. I can't learn this. And Peggy is always able with her team to step in and say, yes, you can.
I try to stay in the background as much as possible when I am pushing into a classroom to help those students with unique learning needs. Usually I take a dry erase board in with me, and I usually just write notes to the student and then take that dry erase board over to the student and I show that to them. And the expectation is written on the dry erase board of what I want them to do.
Okay.
And they will usually comply with that, whether it's please take notes now, uh-huh. whether it's please open your book, whether it's please listen to your teacher. And then we just go from there and then help them to know what the next step is so that they can be successful in that large group learning.
Sure.
Yeah, it really works great. You know, Catholic Schools Week is about all of our kids, right? So we certainly celebrate, you know, maybe the star athlete and that genius level learner that just brings something great that they've accomplished, and we want to celebrate that. But I think what makes our schools uniquely centered on Christ is that we celebrate every child.
Yeah.
And, you know, there might be people out there who think, well, Catholic school isn't equipped to help a child that maybe does have attention deficit disorder. Maybe they have an autism diagnosis. Maybe they have whatever other thing. And we may not be able to serve literally every need that exists in the world, but we can serve so many of them.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, what we're talking about today is fundamentally bringing love. And Peggy really does that at a time when a child might be at their best,
yeah.
but at many times when they might be just for that moment, possibly, you know, at one of their worst moments, right? You don't want to have that meltdown. You want to be here to learn, and we believe the good about you at all times.
Right.
And she helps that child know that they're loved and have that good. So, you know, I think too, sometimes a listener may not know about how we work with teams, because we tend to think about, you know, okay, a lead teacher might be the only teacher in that room, or in a younger grade, maybe they have an assistant. But Peggy, as she has said, she does oversee, but it's such a team. I don't think you would ever use that language, two of our wonderful team members here. And
one of my favorite things to do is I get to go into the and talk with the teachers every Monday also, and we get to strategize on how the different skills and the different approaches that they can use with the special needs learners in their classrooms. That's very rewarding for me also.
All right. Well, and thank you both. Yeah,
absolutely. And do we have time, Kyle, to share kind of one last thing about
sure.
our resource program? Just kind of think about where you see Christ, you know, as an administrator, you know, Spirit in the schools. Where do we see the Holy Spirit? Well, our entire resource program, as we've talked about today, definitely shows me the Holy Spirit. But there's an element that it might be hard for a parent to imagine. But if, you know, if somebody is professionally engaged, if they're working in whatever career, we all know a little bit about, okay, when can I really dial in and focus on whatever my task is at hand, right? So I'm really going to engage in this mentally. I'm going to get this task done. And I think where our Catholic educators really show Christ, and Peggy does this to a wonderful degree, at schools, you might really need to do that, but have that interruption. Okay, all of a sudden in one of the other classrooms, we have that child that's in that tough moment, mm-hmm. right? And he's not going to say, well, you know what? Let me have that meltdown in a half hour from now, you know, right? And Peggy is so willing to just kind of throw that task off to the side for a moment. And it is important. She'll go back to it and get it done and say, this child needs my help right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to put away what I was doing and sacrifice that. And it can be so hard to organize when you have that, Peg, you know, to keep your day going. But do you know what it looks like to the homeroom teachers or to me? Because I might be pulled in too. And it looks like a joyful, loving, purposeful choice. And I think that's really what I wanted to say to our listeners today, is that that's what we feel about Catholic education. It's a purposeful, loving, joyful choice. And you know, today we're talking about those moments that are a little bit harder, but that's what makes us a Catholic school, right? Because 90-whatever percent of the moments are working as they should, you know?
Yeah.
And it's those 1, 2, 3%, whatever. And so Peggy, really, thank you. We're just so happy we could have you with us today.
Thank you, Mr. Coyle. Thank you, Kyle.
All right, thank you both.
Amen.